following program on Other Derana 24 is classified for general audience. It is intended for all ages. It contains little or no violence, no strong language, and little or no sexual dialogue or situations. The following program contains opinions of the participants and does not reflect the views and beliefs of the Derana Media Network. The network believes in a safe space for all ideas to be expressed and on its duty to create such a platform for free speech. Viewer discretion is strictly advised. From Studio 24 in Colombo, for a real view, real opinion, and for an honest conversation, it's time to get real with Mahieash Johnney.
A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Get Real, where we talk to notable newsmakers here at home and abroad as well. Tonight's discussion is not about politics or not about economy, the usual things that I start hammering here on Get Real, but it's actually very timely because of the simple fact that the entire nation, the entire world is talking about it. It is none other than Sri Lanka cricket and the status of cricket in this country. A veteran in the field is here with me, Sidath Wettimuny. Welcome to the program. Good to see you. Thank you for being here. I really appreciate you're coming on a day where you got appointed to the National Sports Committee by the current minister. Yesterday, he appointed the entire team, and you're part of it. Are you part of the selection committee for cricket as well? Not yet, because we were told the leader of that entire committee was appointed, but the entire members were not provided. But thank you, Sidath, for being here. So, cricket seems to be a big question mark for a lot of fans in this country because they love the game. You're a beloved legend of our sports, of this format of the game, and you all are the pioneers of this entire field. Test status was given to Sri Lanka in 1982, and from that point onwards, you've been playing. And you have a lot of opinions about the fact that how things are running. So the best place to start is the recently concluded World Cup 2023, the ICC World Cup. What happened to Sri Lanka? Is this it for Sri Lanka?
Good question, Mahesh. I think it's a good place to start. And I must say, it's always easier to have a post-mortem or talk about what went wrong. So I have to begin by saying whatever I say is just my opinion.
Yeah, exactly.
And I hope some of the things I say are looked at as constructive criticisms. So to begin with, you see, if you take that World Cup, I think one of our problems in that World Cup was one of leadership. You see, in any team, you need leadership which is strong and must lead by example. And I think I still remember two matches to go at the end of the Asia, before the Asia Cup. I spoke to Chief Selector Pramod there, and I was just having a chat, and I was saying, look, you have a problem of leadership.
Where is the problem with the leadership? Is it with the team, the selection
committee? No, I'm now talking about captaincy.
Okay.
Dashun, I feel sorry for him because if he was allowed to just play, be a player, he's the sort of guy who will play in 10 matches but give you three great innings, and that could turn a game. But that was not meant to be. He was under a lot of pressure during that team, and I felt that was a huge problem we had of leadership. You see, if you go back in time to 96. Let's start at 96.
Yeah. The golden year.
Yeah. We had a team which was building from about 93, 94. 96 came and we had a very well-established unit. We had a captain who was very strong. But, people talk about him as a captain, but I would talk about him as a batsman. He was one of the best left-handers in that time. Not just Sri Lanka, all over the world. So he led by example. You know, if I was to bet my life on who will save a match, I'd say Aravinda or Arjuna.
Yeah.
That was the kind of leadership we had. So he led by example. And then, of course, he was a very strong captain. And when you have a strong captain, you find the team rallies around the captain. There are no two, three captains. There is one solid unit. And if you look at Mahela, Kumar, Sanath, they all were strong captains, but before being a captain, they were fantastic players. Fantastic players. So it was unquestioned. The leadership was unquestioned. And I feel very sorry that we had a situation where, you know, we didn't have that particular leadership I feel we should have had. So that's one of the bigger problems.
When we're talking about leadership, leadership cannot be obtained within, you know, two matches, three matches. It needs to be seasoned throughout. Now, one of the things that we keep seeing in these teams is the fact that these guys are very young, very, very inexperienced. It shows in the field that they are inexperienced. Certain calls they make, certain decisions they take on the field when the match is, you know, at its thickest. We see that. And that is not been addressed, and it has not been addressed, I think, for quite some time, since Angelo Matthews departed. Up from that point onwards, there is no mechanism to get these guys, like, okay, this guy is a captaincy material, he could be trained this way, we can actually push this guy. Nothing of that sort.
Okay, so interesting question that you asked, and I was just getting into that. You see, the team composition. When I look back, I feel one of the mistakes we've made is we have juggled with players far too much. If you look at the two teams, the runners-up and the champions,
yeah,
I think 9 of their test players played in these teams. So if you take our cricket and go back maybe 4 or 5 years, the core of our team, you know, we started doing what other countries are doing, maybe having 3 different teams for 3 different formats. I mean, I don't agree with that at all. Your key players must be the core of every single game you play. Because whether you play Test cricket 50-over or 2020, your skill is the same.
Yeah.
It's the mindset change that makes you a different player. Now, if you take our guys, you mentioned Angelo Matthews, Dinesh Chandimal, quite a few of them, they were the core players. They were the guys who had runs behind them.
Yeah.
But then you'll find when you're in a series, you play a test series and then you're left out of the 50-over, you're left out of the 20.
Mentally, it affects.
Mentally, it gets you down. Now, just imagine Angelo Matthews went back to the team and what his state of mind would be. You know, he is the biggest run getter in the country so far, maybe, him and Dinesh, right? And then you go back to the team like a novice, like a beginner. You're just entering a squad. So the mindset isn't right. And I think we need to correct that. We need to figure out what our core is and stay with the core. You know, I'll tell you a very interesting thing to explain what this mental switch is. This is an interesting story. You know, we were playing in Nagpur in 1986, our test match against India, and Sunny Gavaskar, the famous Sunny Gavaskar, was batting, and now he's known to be a very sedate, calm, quiet player who'll tire the opposition down, right? We had Ashanta Dimel, who was an exceptionally good bowler. He was quick. He was one of our best. Now, he was bowling on this green top and he hit Sunny Gavaskar on his ribcage. I have never seen anybody do that, hit Sunny Gavaskar on his ribcage. Sunny just, you know, took a deep breath, rubbed his rib and took guard. The next ball, he hit him through the extra cover boundary on the back foot and said, pick that up. We were just shell-shocked. I was at slip. I was shell-shocked to imagine that he would do that. Ashanta goes back, comes charging in the next ball, short of a length, not very short, ribcage high, and he pulls him to the boundary and says, pick that up. pin drop silence in the grounds. That was the last ball of the over. Suddenly, Sunny runs up to Ashanta, holds him by the shoulder and says, "Sorry, mate, I lost my cool." Just to, you know, I'm trying to show you what that switch does. So it's the same player who can play different formats based on
That's the thing. Now, when we were growing up, we saw these youngsters. I think the best example I can give you is Sangakkara. When he came into the team, he was a youngster. But beyond that, he had a lot of big players that he can actually learn from. There were so much of players put in the team which are stellar, you know, giants. So here we have a young guy coming into the team, molded by these big players, and then slowly taken into the top position. That is not happening right now, Sidath. That is, nobody's even thinking right now. You said there is a problem with that. Who's going to fix it?
So that's up to the selectors to figure out how they select a squad. You see, selectors need to be bold. I always say, you got to make difficult choices and you got to make it when it happens. Now we have come to the crossroads. We are looking at the next 4 years. And I think it's time that we set, the selectors need to say, okay, what's our two-year plan? What's our four-year plan? And then make a call now as to who is going to lead us. You know, I'm going to venture out and say something which I may be doing the wrong thing. But when I look at the body language of our team now, you know, the demeanor, the conduct, the ability, everything. You know, I would pick a guy like Charit, is he Asalanka or Akalanka, to lead us into Asalanka. The next 4 years. Because you got to pick somebody and say, I'm going with him, and then build the team around.
Yeah.
And that's what we did in the past. You know, we brought in guys when they were just looking as if they're going to be leaders. And that's important. And the selectors need to do that now before we start our next term of, you know, the next 4 years.
Let me ask this. I know, you know, it's not the most popular thing to, criticize about when you're talking about the selectors. Should it be all players, all past players? Because they need to understand the mentality, just what you explained during your time, the mentality of a player, because the person, like, let's say a manager might not understand sitting in you know, good, comfortable places. You know, you can say, why the hell can't you play the way you were supposed to play or anything? We can criticize. A lot of people do it on Facebook and social media because that's the easiest thing to do. But understanding the mentality of a player at that particular crucial moment, like for a simple example, when the World Cup is completely shattering and falling apart and you know you are part of it, that is a massive amount of mental stress, Sidath.
Yeah. So we have selectors who have played the game at the highest level, you know. As I said, it's easy to be critical after an event, and I have to say
But do they have the power?
They should. When you are a selector, you are given the right to make the call. If I am a selector and I am not allowed to make the call, I would say, here, I'll walk away. And that's what the selector should do. If they can't make independent choices, then they mustn't be there. I've been a selector
because
many
times. Because what we see is a lot of decisions are made based on political decisions.
That I can't comment on.
But that's the problem, because if we are going to fix cricket, and if it is basically a player's game, where the participants of that particular format of the game needs to make the call, if Arjuna Ranatunga can be part of that entire, you know, critical moments when he took the decisions, when he how he did, and steered us towards a World Cup, like that, the selectors should be able to take the call based on the game. We don't see
that. Of course, that's a gimme. You know, you're appointed a selector or chairman of selectors, and you just got to make the right call. If you can't, you must step down. So that's
You think the new person would be able to do that?
Well, I can only hope so, you know. And I would tell them, if you can't make your own choice, don't stay there.
In the current World Cup, what was the biggest mistake Sri Lanka did? In terms of, like, let's say...
You know, it's difficult to pinpoint and say this is what went wrong. But I told you what the bigger problems are. A problem of leadership, composition... And that came with time, you know. This composition of our team is a thing that builds up. So when you don't have your core together for a while, look at the Australian team. Somebody was saying there are 9 test players in that team.
Yeah.
9, that's nearly, you know, you're talking about 90% of the team. So those are things we need to focus on and make sure we don't get it wrong, because that is a problem. The next problem I see is not a problem. You know, I really think we have come to the stage and time that we localize our coaching staff or support staff. For a start, I think we have a hell of a lot more than what we need. You know, when Dev Watmore was the coach, we just had Alex Kunturi and Dev and a manager, Dulip.
Cool guys.
Dulip was also fantastic in that, you know, he didn't say much, but when he talked, he meant what he said and everybody listened. We have coaches, batting coaches, bowling coaches, and I don't know what. The biggest problem we have is I don't think our guys understand the language. So it's about time we follow maybe what the Indians are doing, you know. Rahul Dravid is coaching India. Why can't we get one of our guys? There is so many guys who are, you know, who can do their job. You have guys like Roshan Mahanama, so many.
Are they really?
Well, have we asked? Have we asked and have we made the condition suitable for them to come? That's the question. And, you know, there was a time, yes, we needed these foreign coaches, but I just feel the time has come that we need to localize. Even physiotherapists, you know, I know fabulous physios around the world, Sri Lankan, bring them in because, you know, in English, you must have listened to that comedy series when somebody says, oh, a four-letter word, it has 10 meanings depending on
how you say it.
Now, our guys, I don't know whether they understand that. And I'm also against having consultants, you know. No disrespect to Mahela. I think a guy like Mahela either should be a coach or not a consultant. Because just imagine a high-profile guy like that is in the dressing room with a coach who speaks only English. Whom are you going to listen to? The coaching role is basically then taken by that local person, you know. For one thing, they wouldn't understand what is being spoken. So, you know, these are things we need to address.
In terms of why do you say that we need to come down to, you know, local personnel in order to coach our teams? Because is it because of the simple fact that the previous coaches that have been here since Dev Watmore have not got it right?
I would say they haven't got it right, but I'm just seeing as a process of advancing our cricket. You know, it's about time maybe we started using our own coaches. Why can't they do the job? After all, those guys, I can mention quite a few, Roshan, Sanath, Marvin, Vaas, all those guys have played at the absolute top. And why do we think they can't do the same job as those guys? And the other thing is, this communication gap is, to me, no disrespect to the foreign coaches and physios. I think we
inability
have
to speak Sinhala.
Inability to communicate what you want to say. At least if you have a Sri Lankan, you know, he'll use a few choice words and say, do this. And then you get the message.
Yeah.
But do our guys get the message? You know, you saw that interview with Kusal.
Yeah.
It was a simple thing asked, but he didn't understand. And I can tell you a story when in 96, when Dev Watmore, and Dev could speak a bit of Sinhala, you know, and he spoke very Sri Lankan sort of Sinhala. He gives a message to Pushpakumara, and Pushpakumara goes with the towel. And he is asked, what did he say? He said, I didn't understand anything and came back. So, you know, we have to understand that. So that's a very important thing I think we need to look at.
Before we go in for a break, did the franchise version of this game, because cricket is now evolving. First, we had Test cricket, 50 overs came. When 50 overs came, everybody said, you know, cricket is now ruined because of 50 overs. And then now 2020 came, 2020 also, you know, everybody's now screaming, saying, no, you're ruining the game, the quality of the game. And then it started becoming a franchise, like the soccer leagues, football leagues in the West. We've now become a franchise. Now, that particular franchise is very successful in India. The LPL is very good. You think that kind of eroded the entire quality of our players? Because
I don't think, Mahesh, I think the timing may not have been right.
The LPL.
Yeah, because we apparently had a lot of injuries just after that. So that's up to the board to figure out when they play the LPL and when they shouldn't, or when the main players should play. It's up to the coaches, the trainers, to make sure they look after these guys and make sure they are fit.
If you're in the national squad, should you be allowed to play elsewhere?
It's a difficult one, you know. There's a lot of money to be made around the world today playing in these franchises.
But you're still playing under the national flag of that particular country.
True. But then everybody plays in the IPL as well. So I don't blame them for going and playing. I think if there's an opportunity to play when there is no cricket, I think that's absolutely fine. As long as it does not clash with your calendar. And as long as there's enough time to recover, that's the key. As long as you have enough time to recover, yes, I don't see a problem in that. That needs to be monitored.
Sri Lankan cricketing legend Sidath Wettimuny is here. I'm in conversation with regard to Sri Lanka cricket and how we can actually get this game back on track and why for the next World Cup, hopefully better results than what we experienced in 2023. This is Get Real. We'll be to Get Real. I'm in conversation with Sri Lankan cricketing legend Sidath Wettimuny. We've been talking about how to revive the much beloved game in this country. We spoke about 2023, the World Cup. What's gone, what's done is now gone and done. So let's focus about the future. Now, you said let's talk about the next World Cup. What is our plan for 2 years, 4 years, 6 years, 10 years? Where do we want this game to be? If you're trying to figure that out, this is my opinion. I don't see we are looking at the entire nation for talent. We're looking at a very smaller pool for people to come and play in the national squad. If we actually expand this, we would find gems. The Sri Lanka Premier League was a good example for us to understand that we have really good players in the northern part of our country, eastern part, southern part. We have a lot of good players, but they don't have the opportunities. And isn't it one of the responsibilities of this sports council that you are in to ensure that, you know, everybody gets a chance?
Yeah, it's sad, Mahesh. I remember in 2014 when I was chairing the interim committee, we decided to bring a combined northern team to play in the Sara Trophy as an invitation team so that we expose the kids to a better quality of cricket. But unfortunately, like many things, when we left, that was set aside. You know, when you talk of local cricket, I have to say one of the most important things is the wickets you play on make cricketers, ultimately. You see, I remember when we were young, we were told, go and play in England, go and play in the leagues, because you'll know how to play on slow wickets.
Yeah.
Your game has to adjust to slow wickets. Likewise, You were told, go and play in Australia so that you adapt to playing on fast wickets. So in a funny way, the wickets make the player because you are trained under certain conditions. Now, I was shocked to hear a few weeks back, a chap sends me a clipping of the three first bowlers in one of our premier games. There were three spinners. What it tells me is these wickets are just
for spinners.
Not ready for first-class cricket. You can't play first-class cricket on wickets like that. So one of the most important things is we need to make sure our wickets are of a standard. They need to have an international flavor, and we do have clubs which have those wickets, but not enough. I think that structure of wickets is very important.
Most of those clubs are in Colombo. What kind of plans can we have in order to get that out of Colombo? Because we have good stadiums in Gaul, in Dambulla, you know, all these parts of the world, but nothing has mushroomed from that particular point onward. That was the idea, thinking that if we move cricket to Gaul, the Gaul entire area will develop its, cricketing experience there. But we haven't seen that happening.
Yes, we certainly have a problem of wickets in the country. In fact, that's one thing I think the president wants to do something about, I was told. Build cricket grounds in the rural sector so that more children can play cricket. Because per capita, I think we have more cricketers, budding cricketers, than anywhere else in the world. So we have the talent. But in fairness,
is that something you know from experience, or you just?
Oh
saying?
Yes, no. I've been around. I've seen children in the south, north. I've been to Jaffna and spent 2 days looking at players. There is talent, but for them to mature as decent cricketers, you need to have the infrastructure. You need to have the grounds, basic grounds, and I'm hoping that before long we can get that in place. You know, without the grounds, where are the kids going to play? You can't play on paddy fields.
The grounds, when you say, when we move the Gaul International Stadium, Dambulla, Pallekale, all these areas, we were hoping that it could actually bring in the local community to that particular ground, and that would enhance the game. But what we see is it's a barricaded area. After an international game is played, nobody can come there. None of the clubs in the area can play there. If you want to play, you have to pay a high fee or something of that nature. So that particular idea of moving it out of Colombo has not exactly, cultivated to a position where we can get those youngsters to be interested in it. So how can we get...
True. In fact, somebody was saying in the south, deep south, there are only two turf wickets. So how do you blood these cricketers? You know, we need to have a program where we actually build basic grounds, nothing fancy, not stadiums, basic grounds with basic facilities, but the right kind of wickets to get players to blossom out, So that I see as a problem. Wickets is one thing, and the grounds, the lack of grounds is definitely a problem. Another thing I'm hearing is that a lot of players are moving from club to club all the time. That, I think, also needs to be addressed because, you see, for example, when I played for SSC, my whole career was with SSC. So there is a, bond which
loyalty.
You build amongst the players. There is the loyalty. Now I'm told there is too much shifting around. So I would maybe look at bringing in a rule where you can't shift for 3 years, like in the football leagues and things like that. So players stick around.
And those clubs, there are very good ones. And then there are not so good ones. The not so good ones are not actually giving any kind of opportunity to any player. If you are, let's say you really love the game, you have the talent, you come into one of these clubs, you don't get the opportunity because it's again the whole politics of things is at play. So how do we, distribute this? Because it's not just the Colombo clubs. Why not start? I mean, the government should step into this, right? Or should the cricket board?
I certainly hope so. I certainly hope so. That's what I've heard, that they want to do that. They want to build basic cricket grounds in the districts and the provinces. And I think it is essential because We are terribly short of cricket grounds. When you look at the number of kids who want to play, there are thousands of children who want to play, but they don't have the facility nor the place. And if you don't have a ground, you know, you just don't play the game. Simple as that.
School cricket. It's actually a good format that will give you the opportunity to be a better player. But it is always not looked at the way Western nations are looking at it. Scholarships are given not based on sports. For a simple example, if let's say the under 15, under 16, under 17, if you are actually becoming a really good player for that particular college or a school, you don't get a scholarship on sports per se. You have to perform on the education. So this mismatch is there because everybody's been told to focus on education per se. You need to have your basic education, that is for sure. But in other countries, when you have got your basic education and then you can actually, you know, come into a position where you get scholarships for the sports that you play and how you perform. That kind of methodology is not here in Sri Lanka at the moment.
I guess not. You see, our school cricket standard, in my opinion, is pretty good.
Yeah.
We have lots of good cricketers around. The problem is post-school, between school cricket and test cricket, we don't have a clear-cut route to succeeding. If you take England, school cricket isn't that great. But when they bring you into the minor county circuit and then the county circuit, there is a clear path and they pick the talent and then get them into a system. So we can certainly improve that in Sri Lanka. I think they're working on it.
Just, I'm curious, how did you get into cricket?
I was lucky, you know, I had a father who was cricket crazy and my brothers played before me. So yeah. I was just following, you know. It was easy for me to be into cricket. My father, in fact, built the first indoor net in this country.
And those types of formats do exist in Sri Lanka, you know, indoor cricket, then, you know, club cricket, all these kinds of formats. Do you think it needs to be brought, I mean, not regulated, but, you know, brought into certain standard? Because I think the problem with Sri Lanka is setting up the standards that would cater to a world-class requirement. Is that something that you think needs to occur, or what we have right now is completely fine?
You know, I don't think I have given it enough thought to think through that complex question. But I know we have talent in our schools. It's about nurturing them to the next step. That is the key.
What is missing in that particular? Because I'm trying to understand is whose responsibility is this? If we see a good cricketer in school level, and you said as soon as he leaves schools and up until a professional level of the game is being where he comes into, or if he really is determined, he will actually forge his path. But if not, whose responsibility is it to take that student or that child from that particular point as soon as he leaves school and to connect him with professional cricket?
So in our system, if you're good at school, invariably a club will pick you, you know, and say, come and play for our club. And that's the
Colombo thing, right?
No, even outstations. And invariably, if you're very good in the outstations, somebody may say, come and play for our school in Colombo or take them into a good club. So that, I don't think, is a problem. It's guiding those guys who are good to continue so that there's a clear path is what we need to establish. Yes.
Let's take a short commercial break. I'm in conversation with Sri Lankan cricket legend Sidath Wettimuny with regard to local cricket and what we can do for the next few years, because we dropped the ball with regard to 2023. Let's see what we can do as we move on, correct the mistakes, learn from our past errors, and actually hope for the best. Let's take some commercial break. Welcome back, everyone, to Get Real. I'm in conversation with Sri Lankan cricketing legend Sidath Wettimuny with regard to the current status of Sri Lanka cricket and also his opinions and thoughts about how we can revive this game and get it back on track and hope for another World Cup win, perhaps next year. I don't know whether it's too early. But there is another area that I want to touch, Sidath, is about this match-fixing thing, because this allegation keeps coming and it's kind of poisoning this whole, you know, enjoyment of the game. A lot of people are vindictive about the fact that, you know, when Sri Lanka loses a game, or what happened during the 2023 World Cup, the scores, we can't even believe when you get hammered in, you know, in that a big margin. That conversation keeps coming in, and that is denting the trust with the fans. And for cricket to thrive, fans are important. You think in Sri Lanka we've taken control of this situation? Do we have? Because everybody who's reporting about issues pertaining to Sri Lankan match fixing is done outside of this country, not here internally. So do you think it is now taken under control?
You know, this is something I only hear about, and I have to say, from what I gather, the ICC has things pretty well under control. They have a very strict code of conduct, and they monitor every country. And those guys have a fantastic team. I know because I have met them. The ICC does a great job keeping an eye and finding out what's happening in our cricket. Worldwide they do it. And I think right now, I must say, I have not heard anything about any match-fixing issues. You know, one thing we also need to be careful about, this is again something I've heard. Players have agents now, and I know some agents, and they're pretty good. But I think the board needs to have a sort of a register or document where they can, you know, figure out who these agents are, because you can have an agent who has a conflict of interest, and then that can cause a problem, because players can innocently say something and get into trouble. So one needs to be aware that there are agents for players, and I'm sure there are lots of good agents who genuinely help the cricketer in advancing his commercial revenue or whatever. But I think the board needs to know who they are, and maybe they should be registered with the board so that everything is above board and transparent. But as far as I'm aware, Mahesh, I think the ICC does a really good job on keeping an eye. That's why you occasionally get somebody caught, you know.
We know that the current minister, is pushing for a constitutional change in the cricket laws. You think that is in the right direction? Is that a step in the right direction?
It is the only direction we can take, in my opinion. If we don't do that change, we are not going to make a change in our cricket. That's my opinion. I think we just have to do it.
What needs to change?
The cricket constitution, and I think now it's in parliament, and there is a select committee which is looking at it. Even I've gone and spoken to them. I think that must come into being, because without that, what I find is, you know, with 147 votes, it politicizes a system, and you will never have people working independently with a voting structure like that.
So what does this constitution bring that is different from what is happening right now?
So I think the KT Chitrasiri constitution has studied all the constitutions worldwide, and they have got a system where there are independent directors, like for example in a bank. So you have a lot of independence, and they will not then be swayed by club loyalty or provincial or district loyalty. You know, they can look at things independently. So there's a really good mix of people getting together for the benefit of the game. And that's all we need, you know.
Who's appointing that entire committee? according to
the minister appointed that committee. It was a very good committee. It was K.T. Chitrasiri, Harsha Amarasekara, Aritha Vikramanayaka, Duminda Hulangamu. So, you know, they are very, very reputed people with credibility who came up with the constitution. And I think it's an excellent constitution.
In terms of... I'm talking about the constitution per se, accountability. Now, we don't see anyone taking any accountability with regard to what... When the game goes wrong, nobody is there to take blame for it. There's no accountability. That's the honest truth right now. But if we win, there is like every cook is claiming a part of the soup. But in this instance, how is accountability going to change in this new constitution?
So there are lots of checks and balances in that constitution. You should really look at it and study it. You'll really appreciate it. That will be a system which will hold good. You know, the independent directors are appointed by five or six fantastic institutions like the Institute of Chartered Accountants, the Bar Association, the Chamber of Commerce, like that. There are six bodies that appoint. And then the whole cricketing structure.
Do they have any experience about cricket?
No, they're nominating. They're nominating independent directors. You know, if you look at the boards worldwide, they're not run by cricketers. They're run by people who understand
Management,
you know, marketing guys, lawyers, all of them. Yes, there is a cricket committee which will run the cricket. So it's a very good system, I think. And I
select committee will get its independence as well?
Yes, the selectors. Then there is a cricket players association. Ladies cricket will be represented. There is the umpires association, the coaches association, and all those guys come from all over the country. So the country is represented.
What's going to be different if this constitution goes through? What will be the difference from what's happening now to the future?
I think there will be a huge difference. Transparency, accountability, and independent decision making. You know, that's what you need. People who can look at the facts and figures and make independent decisions without any bias. That's what we need. And that's what can happen with that constitution.
Sidath, are we following some other nation's blueprint on this as well, or are we just doing our own?
No. So I think that committee has looked at many constitutions worldwide. And they're put together.
The reason I ask you is this: we have this tendency to look outside of Sri Lanka because apparently everything what we are doing here is not good for us. So we'll look at the West, the East, wherever, and then bring that and try to embed it into our society. Doesn't work because our culture, our norms are quite different. Is this a similar exercise like that, or did the people who actually did this really understood the problems of our game right now, problems of what is happening here, and then address it?
I would certainly think so. They looked at all the constitutions, but they came up with something which they felt was suitable for this country. Only time will tell, but I have no doubt it will change things for the better.
Sri Lankan cricketing legend Sidath Wettimuny, I really appreciate you coming and speaking to us here on Get Real. First time, so don't make it the last. Make sure that you keep coming and sharing your ideas. I mean, now you have an added responsibility with the sports committee. Let's see how things would roll out to be, because what we also need is, I mean, whatever said and done, Sidath, the game actually brings a lot of people together. And it creates that harmony, and that is something we are missing in this entire nation, what we really want in order to rally around. So cricket has done that for us, and we really hope that we can continue to enjoy that particular sentiment regardless whether, you know, even if you are not a cricket lover, when you are winning, we tend to love the game and that move. Sidath, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Well, that's all the time we have for you tonight. Thank you very much for watching. I'll be back again next week with another episode of Get Real. See you then. Bye-bye.
You pile up the corpses, exhausted your sources, living right under a cloud. The odds are against you, the gods haven't blessed you. You better get back on the rails. Drop down on the data, keep pushing the paper. The debt's dripping down on the walls. It's a million to one, there's a place in the sun to dance with the big boys again. You don't even know my real name. It's a strange game. You got to carry a plane in this strange, strange game. You're out on a limb trying hard to get in. It's a strange game.